is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast host. I have an awesome episode for you today. You know, we mix up the format a little bit in the Thriving Dentist Show. And this format, I have an interview from someone that you likely already know. And if you don't already know my guest, you're in for a real treat. My guest today is Fred Joyal. Hey, Fred, how are you?
Fantastic, Gary. Great to see you.
And let's just let the cat out of the bag, Fred. The interview that we're doing today is to talk about your new book. And the book is titled Super Bold. And I was privileged to receive a pre-publishing copy, and I've had the privilege of reading it. And Fred, I got to tell you, you knocked this one out of the park. This book is absolutely amazing. And it is such a powerful, the content is so powerful, not only for our profession and for health, you know, for dental professionals, whether they be dentists or team members, but this is a book that extends far beyond our profession. It's really a book that everybody needs to read.
Yeah, and the title Super Bold. I always make sure I pronounce the hard D at the end because they go, "You wrote a book about the Super Bowl?" It's like, no, it's about how to go from whatever level of confidence and boldness you're at to whatever level you want to get at.
Right. And I love your subtitle, which is From Underconfident to Charismatic in 90 Days. And
it
you
can
deliver.
Be done.
Well, you deliver on that because not only is the book full of content related to the character of boldness, but it actually is as much a workbook as a content book. And the workbook makes everything actionable. And I love that because, Fred, you've heard me say that information's great, but information without application is merely entertainment. And now,
exactly.
I mean, I'd like to think that what you and I do when we're speaking or we're running workshops or whatever, I'd like to think it's entertaining. And I'm sure you would as well.
Yeah.
But perhaps more importantly, I think both you and I feel much better when we know what we've shared is actually being applied.
Yeah. I'm much happier when somebody comes up to me and says, "I read Becoming Remarkable. My whole team reads it. We changed everything that we're doing. We're up 30% this year." It's like, yes, that's what the book's about.
And by the way, I enjoyed the book. But I'm also up 30%.
Yes.
So. Hey, Fred, let's back up a little bit before we take a deep dive into the book. You know, we have new listeners all the time on the Thriving Dentist Show. Yeah. We're now up to listeners in 188 countries. May I take a stab at credentialing you and then you correct me for accuracy and maybe add to it for any of our new listeners that may not be familiar with you. Would that be all right?
Sure.
Yeah. And for the record, Fred and I have known each other for, my goodness, I was thinking about it the other day and I think we're coming up on 35 years.
Yes.
Is that possible, Fred?
It doesn't seem possible because we're both in our 40s, you know, so it's not.
I think we've known each other personally and professionally for 35 years. And I count you as not only an amazing colleague, but one of my dearest friends on the planet. And from a professional standpoint, I like to credential you. Whenever I introduce you to people that I know, I like to say that you know more about how the dental consumer thinks than anybody I know on the planet. And that comes from your experience in co-founding 1-800-DENTIST and running an organization that would, I'm not sure how many millions of connections you made for people looking for a dentist, but I know that number is in the millions.
Yes, it exceeds 10 million at this point. So.
Yeah. And you're the best-selling author of two books, Everything is Marketing, which is exactly what the title says. And you went through a brilliant book on everything is marketing. And you wrote a sequel to that that kind of brought things up to date in the digital age. And it was titled Becoming Remarkable. And so this is your third book, Super Bold. How did I do at credentialing? Would you add to that?
That was it. You know, those books were for the dental industry, and they were everything that I knew about marketing and advertising to the, you know, based on, you know, millions of consumers contacting us and spending $500 million in advertising to attract consumers and surveying patients and all of that. This book is everything I wish I knew when I was 20 years old, that I had to figure out the hard way. So it's aiming at a bigger audience, but it's certainly applicable to anybody as a dentist working in a dental practice that is trying to increase their confidence and their boldness from whatever level they're at. I've talked to several people who've read the book now that kind of surprised me, because they're kind of bold people in my mind, and they're like, yeah, I'm pretty bold, but several things in the book showed me I could be much bolder. I want to be super bold. And so it's interesting, because I thought this is maybe for a younger audience, that are people trying to find their way, like I was in my 20s. But everybody at every level seems to be getting real value out of it and taking themselves from good to great. Those are the easiest people to coach, aren't they? Right?
Absolutely.
Somebody who's already good knows they can get better and wants to figure out how.
Well, so. And based on our personal relationship for all these years, I know something about you that maybe other folks don't, although if they read the book, they will learn. And that is that you yourself weren't always bold. See, I know you, and I think of you as a brilliant example of someone who walks the walk on boldness. But that wasn't always the case.
Not at all. No, I grew up in the category of painfully shy.
And for people that know you today, I think they'll have a hard time kind of coming to grips with that, because that is not the Fred that I've known for 35 years.
No, it's, it made me unhappy. It made me angry sometimes at all of the times that I hesitated and I missed great opportunities, possible great relationships, great adventures, and just great moments, just because I was too shy, too hesitant, too underconfident. What most of us do when we hit an underconfident moment is the brain goes into the worst case scenario, right? This is the worst thing that could happen. People will laugh. I'll be embarrassed. I'll fail. The brain's great at coming up with how bad things can go. Bold people have figured out that 99% of the time that doesn't happen. And if it does happen, it's not a big deal, right? They laugh it off rather than go, whereas other people would shrink and go like, crawl back into their shell. The bold person goes, wow, that could have been humiliating if it wasn't so funny, you know?
Well, and I'll share, because it's in the book, so, you know, I can't wait for our listeners to read it, but I'll share with you that this extends personally as well. And you share a very personal story from your life, kind of amplifying the concept of being super shy and how boldness would have been the right approach, but you just didn't have it at that point. And that was when you had the opportunity to eulogize your father. And if you might, would you mind sharing that? And, at a very personal level, kind of sharing, that experience in your life and maybe how that, among others, really, you know, pivoted you to make some changes.
It's a perfect example of something that you get one shot at. And it's true of a lot of things in terms of opportunities where if you're not bold, if you don't step up, that fleeting moment is gone forever. And I was just too young and no confidence to get in front of a room and say anything. And so I didn't prepare anything. And there was just the funeral, the wake and everything. And that was it. I look back on, you know, now I look back, I was in my 20s when my dad passed away. I look back and think, you know, I was just too young to even get to know him as an adult. Never mind express my appreciation to him for all the sacrifices he made with me growing up. I mean, he was always there. He was going to be home when I got home. I was going to be able to borrow his car. He was going to lend me money as I was trying to figure out my way, because I was a vagabond and a wanderer and a directionless guy for many years. But I did get to eulogize my mom, and it made all the difference to be able to honor her. And you get one shot at that. Yeah. So,
yeah. Well, Fred, thank you for sharing that. And I think that resonates with our listeners, or will resonate, in many ways with our listeners. So, hey, I've got some questions for you. Can I fire away?
Yes.
Well, it's the title. What do you mean by super bold?
The super bold means you have gotten your confidence, your boldness to a level where you can act no matter what the situation. Nothing is going to hold you back. If you want to meet somebody, you're going to meet them. If you want to try something, you're going to try it. If a moment presents itself, you are not going to think about it a long time and overthink it and talk yourself out of it. You are going to act. You're going to have the ability to be energized and relaxed at the same time, be able to say what you want to say, think of what you want to say, have that experience, have that interaction. And you know, my goal is to make the world a bolder place. I think bold people are the ones that make all the difference in the world. And I want more bold people. We got big problems. I want people, you know, stepping up and trying to solve the world's problems and believing that they can, because a lot of it is when you believe you can, and this is the neuroscience behind it. And you know this, of course, because you're always coaching people, but when they have goals and they believe it's possible, the brain steps up and says, I guess we got to figure this out. And it gets creative and it works in your subconscious. That's why people think of stuff in the shower, right? It's like, because it's running in the background. Right. But if you decide it's impossible, the brain goes on vacation, right? Because the brain is an energy conservation device, right? It's 2% of our body weight and burns 20% of our calories. So it's looking for any way to not work. So if you go, that's impossible, they go, good, I don't have to think about that anymore. So I
loved every part of the book, but I have to tell you, the way you have seamlessly integrated neuroscience in a cool way is just absolutely invaluable. And so it explains so much, doesn't it? We're learning, there's been many advances in the last 10 years about what we know about the brain and neuroscience. Yeah. And I incorporate it into, how I work with doctors to increase their case acceptance, increase treatment acceptance. Because if you think about it and you think about how the brain responds, if we go back to the caveman days, we were either in, fight or flight or rest and digest. And there was that was about it. We know today, now think about the crazy world that we live in, and the merry-go-round spins pretty fast. Pretty much everybody, most of the time, is in fight or flight. They're not subconsciously, they're not thinking about it. But if you can subtly switch the brain over to rest and digest, there's an opportunity for so much comprehension and understanding to happen. And especially in dentistry, Fred, the mind of the consumer. And I think it's fair to say that virtually every patient in a dental office is subconsciously in fight or flight. Would you agree?
Yeah, and as we know from the science, when somebody's in an apprehensive or an anxious state, there's a whole different set of chemicals running through their body, and the body is it's in a mode that's trying to protect itself. So it's not creative. It's not positive. It's not open. No, it's using, it's limiting cognitive skills, because it's like, I don't need to think about stuff. I need to be able to react and protect myself. It's right. We get the same chemicals and the same reaction in our body if it's a saber-toothed tiger going to bite our head off, or we're worried that something's going to be more than we can afford. Right. Fascinating but that's who we are. We are in this body with this, you know, set of neurons. And so and there's a real power when you're confident as a dentist and presenting, that makes a huge difference to somebody who's listening to you. The dentists I know who are so successful is they are that way, that they absolutely believe that their skills are top notch and that what they're recommending to this patient is the best thing possible.
Absolutely. Well, I love the way you have so brilliantly incorporated neuroscience into the entire book. It's not a text. It's not a textbook. It's just fascinating.
No, it's not not a science book.
So. Don't worry, there won't be on the midterm. It's really brilliant because it has so much application. I think I know the answer to this, but I'd like to ask it anyway. Who's the book for?
It's really for anyone who wants to be more confident than they are now. Anybody who feels like they've missed opportunities, that they've missed sales, they've missed relationships, they missed adventure, and they feel in the grip of something holding them back. And sometimes it's the stories they're telling themselves or the voice. I call it Dr. No, the voice that's telling you everything that's going to go bad and why you shouldn't do this. And because bold people have Dr. Yes talking to them. Yeah, like, yeah, let's go. You know, let's try it. Let's see what happens. And I say charismatic, you know, you can go from confident to charismatic, because that's how people perceive you. It's not me going, oh, I'm charismatic. It's like people will see you, that you're so comfortable in your confidence and your boldness that they see it as charisma. You are magnetic to people. We're all drawn to those people. Sometimes if they're so bold, they freak us out, but they don't care. Right. That's like you're telling this story. It's like, oh, they're a show off, you know, they're attention whores and stuff like that. It's like that. No, they're just getting the most out of life. And why wouldn't you want to live a life that you're proud of, that you didn't miss many opportunities instead of, you know, I think people, you know, I don't think people give up on their dreams because they failed. I think they gave up most of the time because they stopped trying. They had a couple of failures. They had a couple of disappointments. They got embarrassed. They got, humiliated even. But a bold person realizes that there's no such thing as dying of embarrassment. It is not a medical diagnosis. It is a thing you tell yourself happened. Embarrassment is a choice, right? You can spill wine on your shirt at dinner, right? And everybody around will look at you and you could be humiliated or embarrassed, or you could say, this is why my dry cleaner loves me, right? And everybody laughs, right? And so it's, again, you just made a choice and you just made the bold choice. Right. But obviously you want to make bolder choices when it matters. Because there's a lot of people who are confident until it matters. I have a good friend who's confident all the time, unless he's trying to sell his paintings, which are superb. They're breathtaking. but he's afraid to ask for good money. He's afraid to figure out how to promote himself. He's missing the confidence when he needs it most. And so, you know, and it could be, it's like, let's say you're seeing somebody that you always wanted to meet. Maybe it's an athlete, maybe it's an actress, somebody like that. And you hesitate to walk over and introduce yourself and express your appreciation for this. As a sidebar, a quick story. I just listened to Steve Van Zandt's autobiography, and he tells this story. Now, this is a guy that's been in rock and roll forever. He gets to meet Van Morrison after 40 years, and he's in the green room meeting him, and Van Morrison is asked to meet him. And so they're chatting a little bit, and he notices there's a vacuum cleaner in the green room, and he says, I don't know any other way to express how much appreciation I have for you and your music and how much it's given me all my life. So I'm just going to clean up a little bit. And he grabs the vacuum cleaner and starts vacuuming the room. And Van Morrison just falls apart laughing. It says, his manager says, I haven't seen him laugh that hard in years. Right. And it's just like, that's such boldness. It's like, I'm going to do something really nutty and see what happens. Seize that moment. So
you've used the word opportunity, in our interview many times here. And of course it's woven throughout the book, but it kind of reminds me of a recent quote that I heard. And this is a quote that has really given me some pause and given me something to think about. And let me just, I'll get it close. Can I go ahead and give it a try?
Yeah.
One of the most frustrating things in the world would be to meet the person who you could have become.
Yes.
I'm getting it close. I may not have it exactly right, but certainly the message of that quote I was able to capture there. But this is a lot of really what this book can help you achieve. Achieve your full potential. Now, I meant to start with this question. I got so excited about talking about the book, but I jumped ahead. But let me back up. What sparked the book? You've written two, and so the act of writing is something that you do very, very well. But what sparked this book?
It went back to a thing that Imtiaz Manji's boys, Rizwan and Kaleem, did many years ago, Young and Motivated, which was a weekend course for young people, teens primarily, to teach them how to manage their time, money, and relationships and set goals for themselves. All the stuff that they don't teach in school. And it was this fabulous weekend course. And me and several of my friends were brought in as mentors. And we would each do a little presentation to the young people. And so one of the things I threw out was that boldness is a superpower. And it really resonated with them. I could see the difference it made. And I would talk to, we would all hear from these kids as their lives progressed, because you would watch them over the weekend get the aha moment, and where they went, this is I actually have to save money if I want to have money, or something like that. And like, which is, this is tremendous gifts. And you need to understand that you don't ever want to be the one that stops you. Okay. Let somebody else stop you. This is what bold people know, is that 99% of the time, nobody stops you. And 99.999% of the time, nothing bad really happens unless you decide to make it bad. And so the book is full of all of these exercises, and they're designed to take you gradually, step by step, so that you're building this boldness muscle without overwhelming yourself, but you're getting stronger and stronger and stronger and bolder and bolder and bolder every day, so that in 90 days, you are meeting that person you want to be. And so I kept hearing back from people, and actually a couple of the teachers in the workshop, and I mentioned one of them in the book. Some of the other mentors were telling their kids this, right? They would go back and say, you know, boldness is a superpower, right? You don't have to hesitate. Go right in. So I've had people doing exercises that show them that nothing bad happens. I say, if you see a sign that says employees only, go in. You know why? Because nobody's going to shoot you on the other side. Nobody's going to, nine times out of 10, nobody even says anything. I mean, it's like I've walked into the back of a grocery store deliberately, right? And nobody will say anything, even though it's a big sign that says employees only. If they say something, it'll be like, can I help you? Right. And you just go I'm looking for the bananas. Right. And they look at you like you're crazy. Right. And they go, they're in the produce section. Right. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I should have looked there first. But it's to make you go into this situation where you go, oh, something, nothing's going to happen.
Well, this
it's building the neural pathway. It's changing. It's neuroscience. It's changing the neural pathway because bold people have this super highway of boldness in their neural pathways, and underconfident people have all sorts of neural pathways that talk about danger, risk, embarrassment, humiliation, failure.
You share a fact in the book that is literally, worth reading just for this fact. And that's that many people have been taught that the brain develops at an early age, and at a certain age, it stops developing. And that's old thinking, and that's old knowledge. And in fact, you share some research and you share some data about the fact that the brain can continue to develop throughout your entire life. Would you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, they have found that you can stimulate different parts of the brain and you can create new neural pathways, which will have more neurons built in it, that the brain will actually keep building neurons. And it will, the more interesting thing is when you start becoming, in this case, bolder and create those new neural pathways, the underconfident neural pathways, those things, those reactions, that program, because the brain is just all code, right? In one form or another, they atrophy, which is fascinating. They become the constricted roadway that the brain goes, I'm going the other way. I'm going the boldness way. Because what happens is the boldness builds the rewards. I mean, we're in a reward system. The brain is looking for rewards and reinforcement. The more you act boldly, and that's the beauty of the exercises, is your expectations are, I'm doing something with nothing in return except to do it and have done it, right? I'm going to smile at 20 people today, and if nobody smiles back, I don't care. Because I smiled at everybody. Because what happens is 19 people smile back and the 20th doesn't. And you just go, that poor guy, he must be having a rough day, right? And all of a sudden, new neurons going, look at all that reward, you know, I feel good about making them feel good, you know? And that's you know, we're getting to one of the big principles in the book, what I call the prime directive, which is to make everyone you meet feel better about themselves. Imagine if we all did that. Imagine the change in the world if that was our intention with everyone we met.
I love the insight about how, and the research that you backed it up with, how the brain can continue to develop, you know, throughout your life. You know, you and I are similar vintage. And I'd like to state for the record that it was a darn good vintage.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Some good years there.
Yeah, we're similar vintage, and yet, our brains can yours and mine can continue to develop. We can continue to mold it, and we can continue to develop it in a really positive way. And that's a breakthrough. You know, in the world of psychology, experts will tell you that you're born with your IQ. The experts in psychology say that, you know, you come out of the womb with your IQ and it doesn't change. I don't know that I fully believe that, Fred, but that's what the experts say. Emotional intelligence, on the other hand, EQ, can absolutely be developed. You know, and, you know, one of the things I've noticed in making my life's work studying world-class dentists is I've yet to meet a world-class dentist that didn't also have a very high level of emotional intelligence. And I'm going to also make a statement in the context of your book. Now that I think about it, I've yet to meet a world-class dentist who I wouldn't also think of as being bold. They are bold. Absolutely. And they're bold about their passion. They're bold about helping patients. They're bold in their behavior. Well, I want to pivot and make it real tactical here, because your book makes everything very, very practical. And you introduce a method you call the PRIDE method. And PRIDE is actually an acronym. Would you share the PRIDE method with our listeners? And then we'll talk a little bit about how the book has these brilliant exercises that convert everything from academic to actionable.
Yeah. So the PRIDE, there's five steps to building your boldness in any situation, to be able to turn to these steps and say, how do I act? Okay, it is preparation, the P, relaxing, insight, dosage, and everyday action. I'll break them down a little bit. Preparation. If you're coming into a situation that you're not used to, or that you want to be confident in, prepare yourself. If you're going in to ask for a raise, if you're going to walk over across the room and talk to somebody, if you're going to introduce yourself to that, you know, athlete that you've been dying to meet, prepare something, rehearse it. I mean, we have this constant message that we shouldn't have to prepare for social situations. Well, guess what? That people who prepare to actually make it work. It's like saying, you don't really, the best marriages, you don't have to work. No, the best marriages are people who work on it, right? They work on communication, attention, all of that stuff. They realize there's work involved. Preparation, first step, prepare what you're going to say, prepare how you're going to react. You know, what are you going to look like? What's your physiology? What's your, all of that. Second step.
Well, Fred, relaxing. Can I back up? Can we pause for just a second? I know you and I enjoy theater, and you also enjoy performing. You've done some very cool stand up, and you know, if you and I are involved in community theater, the producer isn't going to just have us show up on opening night. They have these things called dress rehearsals.
And
some practice.
I mean, and they go really badly.
Yeah. But isn't that what you're talking about in preparation?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And the next step is relaxing, is that a lot of people say, well, just relax. It's like, okay, well, tell me how. I'm going to tell you how. There are some simple steps, techniques that you can use to relax yourself, because when I walk on stage, and you're the same way, when we walk on stage, people say, are you nervous? No, it's like, I can't wait to get on stage. I've transformed all that anxiety into feeling energized. I'm excited to get in front of those people because I know how to, I'm relaxed. I'm not drowsy. I'm fully energized, but I'm completely in my core. I'm completely relaxed. And so there's a couple of techniques. There's breathing exercises, very simple ones that I teach in the book, and a couple other things. The next step is insight. And I've talked about those insights, but it's having insight about the situation and about things in general. The big insights, nothing bad's probably going to happen. And I won't actually be harmed, right? And that the upside is probably waiting, and failure is just another step up. That's what bold people see. Failures is a stairway up, right? Whereas the underconfident people go like, failures is a barrier. It's like a field of landmines, right? The next step, D, is for dosage. Control the dosage of the experience, the intensity of that experience. If you're incredibly shy, don't say, I'm going to go to a party and I'm going to meet everybody. Go to a party and say, I'm going to meet one person and have an in-depth conversation. Don't overwhelm yourself. You're going to move out of your comfort zone into your discomfort zone, but you're not going to go 10 miles into your discomfort zone. You're just going to keep expanding it by moving in just far enough where you get stronger. Then you come back and refresh yourself in your comfort zone. So controlling the dosage of these experiences as you build your muscle, it's just like with doing anything. You wouldn't do it with exercise. You wouldn't lie down and say, I want to be able to bench press 300 pounds. So I'm going to start with 300 pounds, right? Because you're going to be crushed to death, right?
As an endurance athlete, someone who does marathons, half marathons, and triathlons, this relates very specifically. You don't run a marathon without some preparation and without some dosage, for sure.
Yes. Yeah. And then the final step, which is critical, is everyday action. We build more for ourselves by what we do every day than with anything else. It's not how much you do anywhere near as much as how often you get to it. Wow. It's about neuroscience, and to translate the neuroscience into something simple is the brain says, oh, I guess this is who we are. If we do something every day, if we're consistent about it, if we do it on the weekends, or we do it when we feel like it, we're a dabbler, and the brain says, this is something we dabble at, right? And so it doesn't, the brain doesn't build the neural pathways. But when you get to it every day, even if you get to it to 5 minutes, I mean, I've written all my books by getting to them every day. Even if it's for 5 minutes, even if it's one, my requirement is one sentence. I'm going to write at least one sentence every day till the book's done. And I'll go a year and I may miss 4 days the whole time. But what happens is I do more, right? But in the end, I got 400 pages. I got too many pages. Now I got to spend every day editing. Yeah. But that's the power of the Pride Method, is all of these steps. So.
Well, that Pride Method, since I've read it in your book, it's become daily activity for me, and it's so powerful. Fred, I want to bring it back to dentistry. I had the privilege recently of spending some time with Frank Spear. Our audience will absolutely recognize Dr. Frank Spear. And I turned to Frank and I said, Frank, can you share one tip that dentists can you share it with one tip with me that I can share with dentists that would accelerate a dentist at any stage in their career, early career, mid career, and late career? And without a moment's hesitation, he said, Gary, can I give you two? And I said, since you're Frank, you can give me two. You bet. And he said, number one, it's kind of tactical, but I would teach him to use digital photos for patient education. And that's because we all know that a picture is worth 1,000 words. He said, number two, I would teach them how to present and how to communicate confidently. With that in mind, Fred, can you share some application of your book to our dental professionals that are listeners?
Yeah, if you are bold enough to ask for more valuable, more, and let's call them expensive cases, more comprehensive treatment plans. I do this exercise with dentists when I lecture, and I say, okay, we're trying to find out who's handling the biggest case in the room. So everybody stand up. And then I go, who's had a case bigger than 50,000? And, or if not, sit down, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. I'll eventually get down to two people with cases over 100,000. I said, these guys have had one case that is more than what the average dentist makes in 2 months, because they're confident enough to ask for it. And I said, and then I say, now, does that person complain about the $100,000 cost? And they go, no, not at all. And I say, and yet the rest of you have people complaining about the $135 charges. right? So when you are confident about your dentistry and bold enough to ask for the treatment you deserve, you're going to make a lot more money, and you're going to create people who are out there with $80,000 of treatment done. Who better to promote your practice? They have to justify spending $80,000. They got the best dentist in the world. That's how they justify it.
They become your super fans.
Yep. So you can find out more about the book and me and everything on fredjoyal.com. And of course, you can just click and buy the book. The book's available on Amazon and Kindle and audiobook, and it's me reading it. So
I love you narrating your own books. I like it when the author narrates their own audiobook because you put the emphasis on the right point. I would recommend that our listeners buy all three forms: buy the physical book so you can make notes in it, buy the ebook so you can read it on your reader, and then listen to the audiobook as well. But I know you've got another site that might be useful for our listeners that might kind of help accelerate the learning because of some of the other features that come with
The workshop. So fredjoyal.com is where they can get the exercises. They can download a PDF of the exercises. If you want to go straight into Amazon, you go into genI.us/SuperBold, and you capitalize the S in super bold. And that goes straight into Amazon where the book is. You can go to fredjoyal.com if you need any of the other resources.
Fred, I'm going to put it for our listeners' benefit. I'll put a link in the show notes. So you can just go to thrivingdentist.com and you'll just scroll down. It will put a link, just one click. It'll take you right to those sites. We'll put both the fredjoyal.com and the genI.us /SuperBold. Remember to capitalize the S. We'll put that in the show notes so you don't have to remember it right now. Fred, as we're coming to the finish line here, I just want to say that, you know what I love about our profession, and I know you and I are simply brothers from a different mother on this one, and that's that we have the ability to change people's lives every day. And I'm going to tie us to this book. Reading this book will change your life. We'll be doing it with my clients as book club. I'll be purchasing it for all my team members, and we'll be doing it as book club in my own office. And I will become a zealot advocate of helping everybody I meet. I'm going to practice some of those boldness skills. I'm going to tell everyone I meet that they need to read this book, and because it will change their life. Fred, thank you. Thank you for 35 plus years of friendship. Thank you for all the professional knowledge and inspiration I've gained from you. My practice wouldn't be what it is today if it wasn't for your influence. And that goes back. We've owned Paul and I, now Paul and Tim have owned that practice for many years, and it simply wouldn't be what it is if we didn't have your influence on our practice. I can't wait to share this book with Paul and Tim and my entire team. I know our listeners take action. So I hope you've enjoyed our interview, but more importantly, I hope you apply it because it will make a massive difference in your life. You can thank me later. You can thank Fred later for that. Fred, on that note, let me simply say thank you. I also want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you for the privilege of your time. And I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.